My message today, I was inspired by my mother. I didn't plan it that way, but as I was meditating on what to preach this Sunday, I felt led to speak about the Holy Spirit. And as I was planning and as I was preparing, I went into my library and looking through some books, and I came across a book that is about the Holy Spirit. And I remembered that book immediately because that was one of the first books I read, or of a Christian nature, shall we say, at least one that I was interested in reading. And it was about the Holy Spirit. And I remembered how that book opened my eyes to another world of a relationship with the Holy Spirit. And I remember how it opened my heart to encounter the Holy Spirit in such a profound way that it transformed my life and the trajectory of my life. In fact, without that encounter with the Holy Spirit, I don't think I'd be standing here today preaching to you. It changed the way I felt about the Lord. Now, as I was flipping through that book, reminiscing how 25 years ago, I opened the cover, and inside the cover was my mother's name, Connie Thurber. I think I have a picture of her and my father and of course my children, their grandchildren on screen there just for a moment. But I remember how she gave me that book. It was her book. In fact, I must have stolen it. I apologize, Mother. But you know, and to give somebody a book isn't necessarily a big deal. But it was a big deal to her and to my father. The reason, they had been pastors for many years. And in the church that they pastored, they didn't have a kind view of the working of the Holy Spirit in our lives today. The gifts of the Spirit, the manifestation of the Spirit. Now, this was 25 years ago. But I remember that in the town that I lived, Halifax, Nova Scotia, that Pastor Peter, I didn't know him at the time, it was 25 years ago, we ran in different circles, and I was a lot younger, so was he, but I remember he would come to a church nearby, a Pentecostal church, and I don't know if my parents told me this, but I remember at least had the inclination that this church, you know, they did strange things. They danced in the aisles and they were worshiping the devil. And so that was the kind of the mindset, shall we say, that at least I interpreted. And so, but it was a big deal for my mother, my father, to embrace the working of the Holy Spirit. It ended up that they had to leave the church that they were pastoring. And so, you know, I learned something both from both parents, but you could say today's Mother's Day. So I learned something there. I learned a lot, but I learned two things, I think, from that, from my mother. One is, have courage. Have courage to do right in the face of negative consequences for doing that action. And secondly, I learned, you know what, keep thinking. You know, they were middle age at that time, or you know, they weren't young. I mean, they were young, but you know, but they were open to changing the way they thought, open to new ideas. And so I learned, don't get stuck. Keep thinking, keep being open to new ways of seeing things. So thank you, Mom, for that today. So this is Mother's Day. Now my message today is best friends, Holy Spirit, and you. Best friends, Holy Spirit, and you. I don't know if the title is inspired by the Holy Spirit or not, the best friend part, but, you know, my son Leo, I think I have a picture of him today. It's family day, so, you know, I don't usually show pictures of my family, but there's Leo, and, you know, Leo, and you can see his sister there, and his mother, my wife Megan. Leo's at an age, he's about to turn three, and he's continually saying of his sister, best friend, my best friend, my best friend, Daddy, and he thinks his sister is his best friend, and I hope that it stays that way, but either way, you know. But I began to meditate on the Holy Spirit, and I really do believe that the Holy Spirit, He wants to be our best friend. I'm not taking anything away from human relationships, but the Holy Spirit wants to be our best friend. When I began to create my message today, I began to meditate on the benefits of the Holy Spirit in our lives, and the number of benefits became far too large for one sermon, and so this will be a part of a series leading up to Pentecost Sunday. But today we are looking at four specific benefits that the Holy Spirit brings to our lives. The Holy Spirit is a huge topic. He has many names represented by many symbols in the Scriptures. He brings various fruits and produces various gifts in our lives. And so the Holy Spirit is a wonderful, huge topic. But today we will look at four specific benefits that the Holy Spirit brings to our lives. But let me say before I get to the four benefits, the Holy Spirit, He is not only wanting to be best friends with perfect people. Now, never forget this. The Holy Spirit, He is the Spirit of Christ Jesus. Yes, they are three, but they are one in nature. The Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. You don't have Jesus having one nature and the Holy Spirit another nature. No, they are different in essence, but they have one nature. And so when Jesus, for example, in the pages of the Gospels, was known as a friend of sinners, you know, the Holy Spirit, in the same way, is a friend of sinners. You say, why do I say that? I say that because for some reason, when we begin, I can talk about the Father or Jesus, and people maybe have an easier time accepting. But when you begin to talk about the Holy Spirit, certain people, they just tune it out because maybe it's been misrepresented how the Holy Spirit is only for the, you know, the perfect people. In other words, you have to have everything together in your life. Live a perfectly holy life for the Holy Spirit to come and do His wonderful things in our lives. And yet I've discovered that is, you know, that's not the case at all. You know, if you could live a perfect life without the Holy Spirit's influence in your life and being your best friend, why would you need the Holy Spirit anyhow? No, I've discovered that when I, you know, embrace the Spirit who wants to be my friend, when I embrace Him, you know, He lifts me up. He causes me to live a stronger life. In fact, when I encountered the Holy Spirit after reading this book that my mother gave me 25 years ago, I had zero interest in the things of the Lord. I wasn't reading Christian books. In fact, I was a little bit antagonistic towards things of the Lord. And so I wasn't prayed up. I hadn't had a fasting meeting. But I read this book and something in it engaged me. And I thought, you know, I want to experience this wonderful Holy Spirit. So I didn't do any hoops or ladders. I didn't do any spiritual gymnastics. I simply said, welcome, Holy Spirit. And He came and He filled me. You know, He changed me. And yeah, He'll make you into somebody who has a strong character, but you don't need to be perfect to experience the Holy Spirit. I hope that is a word for somebody here today. First benefit of the Holy Spirit in our lives, the Holy Spirit, He will turn your wilderness into a fruitful place. He'll turn your wilderness into a fruitful place. What does a wilderness speak of? Wilderness speaks of being stuck in a rut. Have you ever been stuck in a rut? It could be emotionally stuck in a rut. It could be spiritually. You feel stuck. You feel, I'm not going anywhere. I'm not progressing. It could be in a relationship. It could be in finance. Maybe you feel just stuck. No, you're not going forward. You're just spinning your wheels. You're not progressing. And so wilderness speaks of that being stuck in a rut. And, you know, we get stuck in ruts for a whole variety of reasons. It could be you were born into that rut, you know, born into a family or a situation of lack. And as a result, that's just kind of stuck with you. You've been in that rut of a lack mentality, lackful life, and maybe finance or wherever. You're born into it. Or it could be you encountered it. It could have been a divorce or abuse. It could be, you know, getting fired from a job. I don't know. You encountered it along the way, or sometimes it's by our own mistakes. We put ourselves in these ruts that we feel stuck. But the Holy Spirit, He wants to be our best friend. And the Scriptures tell us in Isaiah chapter 32 and verse 15, the Spirit is poured out upon us. Now, that happened in the book of Acts. The Spirit has been poured out. And He says, when He is, the wilderness becomes a fruitful field. You see, that's the influence of the Holy Spirit, the wonderful Holy Spirit in our lives. He turns our wildernesses, those areas where I'm stuck in a rut, and He makes them fruitful fields. You know, God wants you to live a fruitful life. In fact, the Scriptures say in John 15 that the Father is glorified when you and I live fruitful lives. That's a good life. And so, you know, when the Holy Spirit is influencing our lives, He turns those wildernesses into beautiful things. He wants to do that for you today. You know, I mentioned earlier that the Holy Spirit is represented by many symbols. I'm not about to give all of them today. We'd have a very long sermon. But two of those symbols are, first, a dove. The Holy Spirit is represented by a dove. And that's pictured when Jesus was baptized in the River Jordan, and the Holy Spirit descended upon Him like a dove. Another picture of the Holy Spirit is fire. When the Holy Spirit descended on the upper room like tongues of fire. And so often the Holy Spirit is pictured like a flaming dove. And I have a picture of it there on screen for you that maybe you've seen an image like that. Now, it struck me this week. You know, the ancient Greeks, and I'm not preaching the Bible from ancient Greek mythology, but the ancient Greeks had a mythology of a bird called the phoenix. And the phoenix was known as it was a bird that lived a long life. And after that long life, it would die, but it would regenerate, or as they said, be born again. And that phoenix was represented as a fiery bird. Now, I'm not saying that's the scriptures or that's the Holy Spirit, but I know how Paul in the book of Acts often likened literature, Greek literature, to draw people, connecting them to the spiritual truths. And, you know, this phoenix bird, it being regenerated or born again, it's where we get the phrase, rise, we still use it today, rise like a phoenix from the ashes. In other words, it means to emerge from a catastrophe stronger, smarter, and more powerful. Now, I'm not, you know, the Holy Spirit is far greater than this Greek mythological bird, the phoenix. But I think there's a picture there of what the Holy Spirit does in our lives as believers. And that's why I say embrace the Holy Spirit. Welcome Him today, because He takes those ashes of our lives. The Scripture says He takes the ashes and He makes beautiful things. But He turns our wilderness into fruitful fields. And maybe you have a wilderness in your life today. It could have been because maybe it's a divorce, and because you've encountered a divorce, you're stuck in a rut relationship-wise. Or maybe you know, things happen. Maybe it was an abortion and you feel stuck spiritually, or stuck in condemnation or guilt, or it could be a bankruptcy. I don't know. But I can tell you that the holy, wonderful Holy Spirit, who wants to be your best friend, He wants to turn those wildernesses into beautiful, fruitful fields. And He can transform any situation. He works in the most unlikeliest of situations. You know, you could say in some way our society, our world right now is in a wilderness. The COVID-19 has locked us all down in something we've never encountered in our lifetimes. And so, and the recession, the economic recession that's hitting our society right now, they say it's only the tip of the iceberg. Friday, they released the jobless report, and it's huge. The economic, the unemployment numbers are very big, and so there's a recession. You could call that a wilderness. And yet, I prophesy to you that when the Holy Spirit's influence in our lives, He can turn for you and I, and for those of who are willing to embrace Him and to welcome Him, that's all it takes. He can turn that economic wilderness into a fruitful field. I said off the top, but even here today, my camera operator on the other side of this camera told me, he's been believing God for a job, and he told me this week in the middle of this pandemic, he got a job. We're seeing report after report of that. But the Holy Spirit, I'm inviting each of us to have a open attitude and welcome this wonderful Holy Spirit into our lives. He transforms us. He turns our wilderness into fruitful fields. Number two, the Holy Spirit's influence in our lives, He brings excellence, promotion, and honor into our lives. Daniel chapter 6 and verse 3, then this Daniel, he was a slave, he was brought as a slave into Babylon, but then this Daniel, he distinguished himself above the other governors. How? Because an excellent spirit was in him. And the king gave thought to setting him above the whole realm. You see, he had a wonderful, excellent spirit within him. And I prophesy to you that when the Holy Spirit is influencing in your life, when He is your best friend, He produces an excellent spirit, which results in promotion and honor. You know, be very careful. If we rely on circumstances to change in our lives to live a fruitful life, we might be disappointed. We weren't promised that all the circumstances of life would be just lined up perfectly for us. In fact, Jesus said we would face encounters and adversity. But with the Holy Spirit, He can change us. And He can put an excellent, and He will put an excellent spirit within us. And so that even Daniel, a slave, the king couldn't resist him. You see, there's something irresistible about you with the Holy Spirit influencing your life. You see, sometimes people think of the Holy Spirit and think it makes people weird or strange. The Holy Spirit doesn't make people weird or strange. It's the Spirit of Christ. Christ was liked by sinners. He was liked by the regular folks. You see, and the Holy Spirit is one and the same in nature. The Holy Spirit doesn't make you strange. It's like some person walking with their head in the cloud. No, the Holy Spirit makes you the sharpest, the person people want to go to for solutions. He puts an edge within you. He makes you excellent in every area. And they, you know, your boss, your employers, whoever, you know, they can't resist promoting you, Trust the Holy Spirit. Welcome Him into your life. I like Joseph, another example of a person who was sold into slavery, and yet he had an excellent spirit. Genesis 41 and 38, Pharaoh said to his servants, "Can we find such a one as this, a man in whom is the Spirit of God?" I believe that for your life, my life, this church's life, that people see us not as, way out there, but people who are filled with the Holy Spirit. Whom there's an irresistible nature to you. They have to promote you. They want to be your friend. Why? Like Jesus, friend of sinners. But the Holy Spirit works this wonderful work within you, bringing promotion and bringing honor. Third benefit of the Holy Spirit, number three, He will cause you. Oh, I love this point. Get ready. He will cause you to walk with God. Ezekiel chapter 36 and verse 27, "I will put my Spirit within you and cause you to walk in my statutes, and you will keep my judgments and do them." You know, when I was a young believer and became interested in the Lord, you know, sometimes you have struggles. I had a desire to overcome certain struggles, and yet I found an inability. Have you ever encountered a struggle? And yet what I've discovered is that by welcoming the Holy Spirit's influence and relationship in my life, He causes me to overcome. He causes it. The Scripture says He works in us to will and to do. Not only does He get us to do it, but He gives us the desire and the joy to do it. That's the wonderful working of the Holy Spirit in our lives. You say, what are the statutes of the Lord? Well, I wanted to know officially, so I looked it up in the Greek, in the Hebrew language where it was originally written. And you know, statute, what it meant? Something prescribed. You know, when you go to the doctor, they prescribe a medication. If you go to a financial advisor, they prescribe you a pathway forward for your finances. Or if you go to the gym, a fitness trainer might prescribe an exercise regime for you to follow. Well, the statutes of the Lord are His prescribed methods of living for, as Jesus said, "I've come that you might have an abundant life." The statutes of the Lord are His prescribed methods of living for the abundant life. Well, good news, the Holy Spirit has come to help us and to cause us and to will us to follow in those statutes. Otherwise, it would be a very hard and arduous thing to do, following all the statutes of the Lord. But when the Holy Spirit, He is empowering and He is helping us, you know, even in the natural, your fitness trainer tells you to follow, we fail. But think of how lofty the statutes of the Lord are. It's a good life, but they're still... But the Holy Spirit, He empowers us, He strengthens us. I tell you at home right now where you're watching, you just say, "Welcome, Holy Spirit." I was in no more of a spiritual mindset than simply able to say, "Welcome, Holy Spirit." The first time that I encountered this wonderful Holy Spirit. And so you don't have to be prayed up, fasted up. Just welcome Him wherever you are. You know, I have some work gloves here right now. You know, these work gloves. You see these work gloves? They look old and work. I've been doing a lot of work in the garden, I guess. See? But anyhow, no. You know, these work gloves, they were designed to work. They were designed to work in the garden or wherever that it is that it might they might work. But just because they were designed to work in the garden doesn't mean they're doing very good work, right? They're just kind of laying here limply. Now, I could say to these gloves, get to work. They don't do a thing. You know, I could even start encouraging these gloves. Gloves, you know, you're such beautiful gloves. You're such good gloves. You have such good, but they're still doing nothing. You know, I could try and train the gloves. Here's how you work, gloves. I'll try to train them. Or maybe the gloves need more fellowship with other gloves. Then they'll figure out how to be good work gloves, right? Or I could, you know, gloves, you need to make a better commitment. That's why you're not doing the things of the Lord. That's not why you're not walking in His ways. You know, you could go on and on. And I think, you know, if you've been in church for any time, you get what I'm getting at. You know, we tell people, this is how you live a good life. This is how you fall after the Lord. Listen, what these gloves need is my hand inside of them. And they take on the nature of the hand and they begin to do the work effortlessly. They begin to do everything seamlessly. You see, in the same way, you and I, we were designed for the abundant life, overcoming life. And yet in ourselves, despite all the encouragement I can give you, despite all the training I can give you, the fellowship I can give you, and that's all good things, by the way, but we must have this wonderful Holy Spirit's influence in our lives. Good news, we have Him, but we have to welcome Him and allow Him and to release Him, and He freely does it. He is a friend of all people, friend of sinners, and He wants to be your help today. He wants to be your empowerment and your strength. Just say, welcome, wonderful Holy Spirit. Fourth point today, fourth benefit of the Holy Spirit, He will make you a a new person. Oh, I just so love this point. You know, we all have things about ourselves maybe we don't like. Well, this is, you know, and you, they say after the age of 30, you don't change much. It's maybe depressing for some of us, but this wonderful Holy Spirit, look at the promise of the Holy Spirit. It says in 1 Samuel 10 and verse 6, then the Spirit of the Lord will come upon you. Remember, these are all Old Covenant verses. The Spirit of the Lord has come in Christ. The Spirit of Christ lives in you. So, you know, but you understand what I'm saying. Then the Spirit of the Lord will come upon you and you will prophesy with them and be turned into another man. You know, that's what happens when this wonderful Holy Spirit comes and influences our lives. He transforms us. He changes us into, He gives us fresh attitudes, new ways of looking at things, and transforms our outlook on life. It changes us into another man. I love it, you know. And I'm not saying there's anything wrong with this at all. If you've had this, don't worry about it. But, you know, we can spend thousands of dollars on cosmetic surgery trying to make ourselves feel better. Now, you can have cosmetic surgery all you want. But if it's done to make ourselves feel better, it's not going to work. Yeah, I could save you thousands of dollars today. Welcome the Holy Spirit's influence in your life. He'll give you a fresh new outlook, a new attitude, a spring in your step. The wonderful, change you into a new person. This is better than cosmetic surgery, and it'll save you lots and lots of money. But you know, and the scriptures tell us, as believers in Christ, yeah, we have the Spirit of Christ living in us, but it says keep on experiencing this wonderful presence, this wonderful reality. You know, the scriptures tell us that keep on being filled with the Spirit, this effervescent glow of the Spirit. Keep being filled daily. I love what Ephesians 4:24 says. It says, put on this new man. You say, well, how do I put on this new man created in righteousness? And how do I put it on? You know, we can try all the hoops and ladders we want, but I don't think, well, the way I've discovered is simply just come with a dependent heart and say, Holy Spirit, I need you. He's closer than a whisper. He's a best, you know, you don't go yelling at your best friend on the park. You're sitting talking to your best friend. You're not yelling. You have a nice, beautiful conversation. He's your best friend. You say, Holy Spirit, I need you. I welcome you. Maybe you have a situation you're dealing with right now. I encourage you, just wherever you are, under your breath, say, welcome, Holy Spirit. Come into this situation of my life. Keep experiencing this reality. You know, one of his names is our counselor. You know, I'm not against counselors. You can go to a counselor, but I'm saying this our Holy Spirit, He is a wonderful counselor. He can also save you thousands of dollars of counseling sessions, but He's a wonderful counselor. You know, I've experienced this time and time again. I know recently, you know, I was getting agitated about something. I know you've never been agitated. You look at me and say, how could you ever be agitated? I was agitated. And, you know, sometimes when you get agitated, the other things begin to agitate you more. And you just kind of go down getting more agitated. And it makes you short and chippy. You know, I know you're looking at me. It's like, how could that ever happen to you? Well, it happened. But anyhow, you know, and I found it going on a couple of days. And I found myself not springing out of it like I normally do. And so, you know, one day I remember saying, Lord, help me. I need your help. What's going on here, you know? And he helped me. He gave me a couple practical wisdom things of little simple adjustments. I don't know how I didn't see it, but it was so clearly before my eyes. But he helped me to see it. And then beyond that, you know what he did? I felt like a spring, you know, nothing really changed in my circumstances. But I felt like just a new outlook, there was a spring in my step the next morning. Nothing changed. That's the wonderful working of the Holy Spirit in our lives. And it's as simple as welcoming. You don't have to pray and fast for 30 days. Nothing wrong with that. He might lead you to do that. But just welcome Him wherever it is that you are right now. He'll turn our wilderness into a fruitful field. He will, oh, He's so wonderful. He will cause excellence in our lives, an excellent spirit. Don't wait on circumstances to change. You change. I remember the Holy Spirit, one of the most beautiful prayers He taught me to pray was, Lord, just change me. Because He begins to work in His wonderful way in my life, and He will in yours. Nothing special about me. And He begins to transform that situation. He causes us. Never feel like you're alone. No, He causes you. There's not a burden. It's a wonderful opportunity with our wonderful Holy Spirit. Maybe you're watching today and you say, I've never experienced the Holy Spirit. I, you know, this is all very new to me. Can I tell you this? The scriptures tell us that when we receive Jesus Christ, we receive this wonderful Holy Spirit and all things are made new. I'll read you the verse and then we're going to pray. 2 Corinthians 5:17, if anyone's in Christ, that's Jesus Christ. He's a new creation. Old things have passed away and all things become new. All things. That means all things. New attitudes, fresh outlooks on life. And He begins to work all the wilderness into beautiful fields. How do you become this new creation? By believing on the Lord and believing on Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior and saying, I receive this new life. I'd love to pray with you right now. If you say, I'd love to receive this free gift to know, A, know that your sins are forgiven, and B, receive this wonderful new life in Christ Jesus. The scriptures say, when we receive Christ, the Spirit comes, the Holy Spirit comes and lives in our hearts, in our minds, in our being. Would you pray with me right now? Say, dear Lord Jesus, I come to you. I believe you died for my sins, but you rose again and you give me new life. Father, right now I receive your Son, Jesus. I receive your forgiveness. Thank you for loving me in Jesus' name. Amen. It's been a privilege to pray with you today. We'd love to connect with you. In fact, you can go to our website, TICC.ca. There's a banner on the homepage. You can go to TICC.ca/salvation and receive. We'll send you a free book. And when the doors are allowed to open here, we'd love to see you in the seats behind me. We'd love to connect, love to meet with you. But congratulations today. Now, if you're a believer in the Lord Jesus already, I pray and I believe that this message has been speaking to you today. An encouragement to reconnect with this wonderful Holy Spirit, to wherever it is that you are, say, welcome, Holy Spirit, into my situation. Maybe you're like me, getting agitated day after day, and you say, I don't know the way forward. Welcome Him. He'll bring the wisdom of Christ. He'll bring the life of Christ, the joy. You know, Jesus was anointed with oil of gladness more than His brethren. The Holy Spirit will give this wonderful gift to you. You don't have to have it all together. I shared my testimony and story. I didn't know thing about the Holy Spirit when I just opened my heart and welcomed His wonderful presence into my life. You see, we must experience the love of Christ experientially, and it's the Holy Spirit who helps us to do that. The scriptures say, and I heard Pastor Peter say it Monday night in Miracle Monday, but our prayer life changes when we experience the Father's love. Faith working by love. Let's just pray. Father, I pray right now for every person watching here today. I thank you that it's not a mistake, but I thank you, wonderful Holy Spirit, that you who have the Spirit of Christ, a friend of sinners, you come right now to each of us. You give us that fresh new attitude, the spring in our step, the wells of joy springing up. Father, I thank you that you're turning wildernesses into fruitful fields. Maybe it's a financial area, Father. I thank you for prosperity and blessing. I thank you, Father. Maybe it's a health area. I thank you that you transform that wilderness into a fruitful field, a relationship, a mindset, a spiritual rut. Father, I thank you, Father, for turning those wildernesses into fruitful fields in the mighty name of Jesus. And everyone said, amen. Well, I believe we're receiving good things here today. I'm so excited to be talking about the wonderful friend, the Holy Spirit.